Hello, today we are talking about prophecy, how to give a prophetic word, also how to receive a prophetic word, and also how to test the authenticity of any prophetic word from someone else. Let's get right into the show. All right, today we are going deep into the Word of God to cover how to receive a prophetic word, how to get a prophetic word, and how to test prophetic words if they're from God, and in short, just all that cool stuff. And so what I want to start with is just like kind of like a definition, but just an easy, simplified version of what a prophetic word is. A prophetic word is what is God saying. Simply put, it's just words from the Lord. And so just know that these gifts are not dead. They're not restricted to the Bible. There are doctrines of devils that say the Lord stopped speaking. Don't listen to them. That's satanic and demonic. The Lord continues. The first and foremost prophetic word, and which is most important, how to sift and filter prophetic words through us, is through the Bible. The Bible is the inspired word of God, inspired in the Greek and Hebrew, meant God breathed. His spirit gave unction and instruction to the apostles, to the disciples, to write specifically. This is not just random inspiration like your imagination. This is John 1:1, the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. So Jesus being the Word also keeps and protects it. So that is the Word of God. And this is how you actually sift, filter, and measure prophecy. Because a prophetic word cannot contradict the Bible, neither can it be sin. So this is the first way that you test prophecy, right? So you test all the spiritual gifts through 1 Corinthians 12. That's the ninefold spiritual gift of words of wisdom, words of knowledge, words of like discernment of spirits, tongues, interpretation of tongues, healing, miracles, faith, and prophecy. Boom. Okay. But the outline of prophecy is in 1 Corinthians 14. I do want to read the entirety because the entirety is of tongues and prophecy. But the harping scripture that we're going on to is verse 3. The measures in which prophecy is supposed to be. But he that prophesies speaks unto men to edification, and to exhortation, and to comfort. That's 1 Corinthians 14:3. So what that means, we're going to read the whole thing, but what that means is edification. Edifice is to build up, all right? So a prophetic word is supposed to build you up in some type of way. So this can be, and again, I'm going to be referencing some other prophecies and prophets that you should check out. One being Robert Henderson and his Courts of Heaven. So into his ministry, give it to it because it's amazing. But in it, it talks about, in the Bible, we're called living epistles. We are scrolls, right? And so the Old Testament is like the Word in the past. We'll just say the New Testament is the Word now. But also, we're kind of living out like the book of Acts. It's in the John, in the last chapter, it says that Jesus did so many things they couldn't all be written in the Bible. And also, Acts is a continuation of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And so as the Holy Spirit is being poured out on us, we, in our stories, are being written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Just like in the Old Testament, the Bible wasn't written while they were living this. Likewise, all this prophecy and everything that we're doing and encountering in the supernatural realm, it also is being written out in the Lamb's Book of Life, right? So we are living epistles, living letters of the goodness of God through revelation and our testimony, right? But with this, you have to know that you actually have a book in heaven. There is a book that the Lord destined you to be, right? And what that means is that it's actually in John. Nope, it's in Matthew. Many are called, but few are chosen. There is, and I know there's a lot of arguments between Calvinist, Reform, Arminian, or whatever. I'm not none of that. I'm Christian. But in it, it says that we are predestined to good works, all right? So not talk about salvation predestination, but it's kind of like that with Romans 9, vessels of honor and vessels of dishonor. But the Lord has set us up to do amazing things. And so when you have a prophetic word, you can actually tap in to someone's book, what the Lord has already predestined you to be, and that's what you're pulling from prophecy, right? So the Holy Spirit gives unction in Ephesians 4. So an unction from the Holy Spirit is like a feeling or an insight. It's a word of knowledge or a word of wisdom that is some type of revelation, and all you're getting, get understanding. And so that is what a prophet's office is supposed to be. A prophet is the trumpet, a mouthpiece, it's the sword, pretty much of like the fivefold ministry of pastors, evangelists, teachers, apostles and prophets, right? This is your gun. This is like your offensive weapon of what the Lord is saying, right? And so the importance of a prophetic word is that it's not vague. It's supposed to be, in short, coming from the Holy of Holies. It's supposed to be coming from the secret place. That's why when you prophesy or when you pray or you speak in tongues, it feels like you're on fire. Why? You're in the glory of God if you're tuning in. If you're not, then it won't happen. And that's why so many people are so wary about prophetic words and how to test it and how to know the authentic versus the counterfeit, because it's so vague, it's so wide. But if you see in the Bible, which we're about to cover, prophetic words are very specific. They're very accurate, and this is why there's three stipulations, I'm just gonna say, or statutes when it comes to a prophetic word. It's supposed to edify, it's supposed to build you up. It's supposed to exhort, right? Exhortation is kind of like instruction. It's supposed to push you in a direction to do something, all right? And it's also supposed to comfort, right? And so this is how you can test every prophetic word, if it meets these categories. And also, you being a Christian, every Christian is supposed to prophesy. We're about to cover 1 Corinthians 14, because this is the best, this is the most holy gift from God, okay? So with that, this is your Batman, this is your utility belt of being a Christian. When you prophesy, it's like, hey, the Bible has to even me out, because you can prophesy from your stomach, which is also called prophesying from the flesh. You are prophesying from your own lusts and desires, which we cannot do. We cannot be emotional or sensational, but the prophecy in the realms of it does not have to meet our intellect. He says, the wisdom of man is foolishness to God. And he uses the foolish things to confound the wise. What that means is that if you think you know God and you think you put all these limitations and you figured him out, he's going to make you look dumb for his glory, so that you humble yourself. So with prophecy, you have to be very gracious when giving prophecy, but also gracious in receiving, because we're just gonna say there's a learning curve to God. Like, we grow up in like all these secular and Western realms of institutions and scholarship, that God is systematic. He has order. He's not the author of confusion. But if you have, in short, just like young prophets that are learning the voice of God, it's a dance. It's you're trying to figure it out. There's a learning curve on it. So you have to be very gracious with people when hearing, but also be gracious with yourself if you miss it. Because what we're going to cover in 1 Corinthians 14 is that we speak in tongues in part, we prophesy in part, till he that comes makes all things full. So Jesus was the perfect prophet. He was always accurate. He knew people's thoughts. That's how accurate his prophecies were. So if we're not gracious with people when we are receiving and being like, oh, you're a false prophet, or you could just get it wrong. We could be human. We're not God, but we're trying to be God's workmanship, being his hands and feet. All right, so the whole outline of speaking in tongues and prophecy is in 1 Corinthians 14, all right? So follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that ye may prophesy. For he that speaketh in unknown tongues speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understands him, howbeit in the spirit he speaks mysteries. But he that prophesies speaks unto men to edification, exhortation, and comfort. He that speaks in unknown tongues edifies himself. But he that prophesies edifies the church. I would that ye all spake with tongues, but rather that ye prophesied. For greater is he that prophesies than he that speaks with tongues, except he interpret, that the church may receive edification. Now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you, except I shall speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by doctrine? And even things without life giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give distinction in sound, how shall it be known what is piped or harped? For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to the battle? So likewise ye, except ye utter by the tongue words easy to be understood, how shall it be known what is spoken? For ye shall speak into the air, it may be so many kinds of voices in the world, and none of them is without signification. Therefore, if I know not the meaning of the voice, I shall be unto him that speaketh a barbarian, and he that speaketh shall be a barbarian unto me. Even so ye, for as much as ye are zealous of spiritual gifts, seek that ye may excel to the edifying of the church. Wherefore, let him that speaketh in unknown tongues pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful. Was it then that I pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also? I will sing with the spirit, and I will sing with understanding also. Else when thou shalt bless with the spirit, how shall he that occupieth the office of the room, the unlearned, say amen, which means let it be so, at the giving of thanks, seeing he understandeth not what thou sayest? For thou verily givest thanks well, but the other is not edified. I thank my God I speak with tongues more than y'all. Yet in the church I had rather speak five words with understanding, that by my voice I might teach others, than 10,000 words in unknown tongues. Brethren, be not children understanding, how be it in malice be children, but in understanding be men. In the law is written, with men of their other tongues and other lips will I speak unto this people, and yet for all that will they not hear me, saith the Lord. Wherefore tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, but to them that believe not. But prophesying serveth not for them that believe, but for them which believe. If therefore the whole church be come together into one place, and all speak with tongues, and there come in those that are unlearned or unbelievers, will they not say that they are mad? But if all prophesy, and there come in one believeth not, or one unlearned, he is convinced of all, he is judged of all. And thus are the secrets of his heart made manifest, and so falling down on his face, he will worship God and report that God is in you of a truth. How is it then, brethren, when ye come together, every one hath a psalm, hath a doctrine, hath a tongue, hath a revelation, hath an interpretation, let all things be done unto edification, edifying. If any man speak in an uncertain tongue, let it be by two, or at most by three, and that by course, and let one interpret. But if there be no interpreter, let him keep silence in the church, and let him speak to himself and to God. Let the prophet speak two or three, and let the other judge. If any be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. For ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be comforted. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. Okay, right. Whew, we got through that thing. All right, so we're going to hit every point when it comes to prophecy and how Paul instructed, because he said, hey, y'all are wilding out and y'all are moving in disorder when it comes to prophecy. So, and speaking in tongues. And this is how I want to outline. All right, so I'm actually going to go backwards. He says, like, hey, when you prophesy, all of y'all should not be having your own individual revelation and interpretation, because this is where error comes from. When you just say everything, and this is where, I'm not calling out churches or whatever, but when it comes to emotionalism, zeal, sensationalism, like a charismatic movement, you can have these amazing people coming back from the dead. You can have people getting healed, the blind to see, but it needs all to be done in order and decency. And it's like, hey, when you prophesy, have two or three to kind of like agree and make a judgment on this thing, to be like, hey, this is how this is happening. This is what, in short, you just have to be mature in prophecy. And part of being mature in prophecy is moving in order, not moving in zeal, but also subjecting yourself to the word of God, number one and foremost, because if it doesn't match here or pass that test, you shouldn't even say it. But after that, submitting to your authority and your spiritual leadership. But if they have you moving in order and decency, being brave, being bold, being courageous to take a step out and be like, hey, I believe this is a word from the Lord. And a great way to test when you're giving a prophetic word to someone else, ask the Lord questions. You don't need a lot of questions, but minimum, the one question you should ask, Lord, give me a scripture for confirmation. I know this for a fact, personal experience. If you have a prophecy, the Lord will pair it, because the Holy Spirit is a comforter, he's an advocate, he's a teacher, he's an intercessor. He will pair it with a scripture, because Jesus is the word. So if he gives you a rhema word, a living word, a right now word that's being spoken to you, he's gonna match you with this, right? And what it says with prophecy is supposed to have peace, and supposed to bring comfort. And so we're just gonna pair this with like end time prophecies and I guess end times in the last days prophecies, right? If prophecy scares you, right? You can have a bad prophecy, but again, it's supposed to edify, to build you up. It's supposed to exhort, it's supposed to tell you what to do, it's supposed to instruct you, but it's also supposed to comfort. So if it just leaves you hanging, you did a bad job as a prophet, a mouthpiece, a priest of God. So you need to ask questions to the Lord if you get a bad prophecy. So if the Lord is like, hey, they're gonna lose all their money, ask a follow-up question. Lord, is this changeable? Are they gonna lose their money because of they're not being a good steward? Is someone going to steal them? Is someone going to rob them? Or is someone going to steal from them? Are they going to get tricked? Are they going to have a bad investment? We get so zealous and so zealous about hearing from the Lord. We're just like, hey, you're about to lose all your money. You did not tell them what they're supposed to do. Can they repent and then they won't lose their money? Can they not have this certain business dealing? Can they, like, there's so many things. So literally, just like school, ask who, what, when, where, why, and how when you are receiving prophecy. And also, when you are getting prophecy as well, you ask who, what, when, where, why, how, or whatever. All these follow-up questions. So you are receiving instruction. You're being built up so that you can do the work, right? And also, this is why you may not always have multiple people at a time, but the Lord gives multiple people instruction, revelation, understanding. So when you receive prophecy, ask for confirmation. Be like, hey, the Lord can send this prophet. He can send someone else. It says the Lord speaks once, but twice we listen. So I don't think God is wary. Like, you don't have to doubt or anything, but just make sure you're not under the criticism of skeptic. Like, a lot of people are really skeptics, but that's the sin of unbelief. That's the spirit of unbelief, which is witchcraft. You don't want to go into that. But 1 John 4 says, test every spirit if it be of God. There are many false prophets out there. So we can't just be out here all willy-nilly thinking everyone's from God. But just because someone gets it wrong doesn't mean they're a false prophet. They just may be young in the faith or immature or maturing. So don't be too harsh. So you move from there. Oh, this is important. Who prophecy is for? It says that tongues, where tongues are a sign, not to them that believe, but to them that believe not. But prophesying service not for them that believes not, not for the unbeliever, but them who believes. So he's like, hey, don't be zealous in spiritual gifts. I think that's also important. I just want to add in there before I continue teaching. I think we're very zealous for things that look cool. But he's like, hey, don't be. But the gift of prophecy is the edification of the church, the building up of the bride of Christ, the body of Christ, right? But it's not for the non-believer. So when you are doing street evangelism and whatever, and witnessing, just know prophecy is cool. It is the more perfect gift, but mostly it's for the body. It's for Christians. It's for believers in the faith. So first and foremost, practice there. Practice in your church. Practice in your small group. Practice in safe environments so you can actually hear the Good Shepherd, which is Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus Christ? He says, my sheep know my voice. They will not hear a stranger. So sometimes that stranger is a stranger within. It's your flesh. It's your own desires. It's your own lust. It's your own sin, bitterness, unforgiveness, whatever. Or your own imagination and zeal. So practice with your own family and friends and see, and be like, hey, I got it right. Step out in faith here and there, and boom, you are good to go. Okay, so that is like how you test a a prophetic word, and that is how you give a prophetic word. It just has to match the Bible. Move in faith, move with grace, and also give grace to others, right? And I want to outline prophetic words as well. So, wait. All right, so I just want to give a couple of examples of what a prophetic word looks like in practicality, so that you know if you're being edifying, if you're being a comforter, and if you're exhorting someone with instruction. So again, don't be zealous in prophetic words. Like, you could ask the Lord. It's like James, he says that to those who want wisdom, he gives liberally. Just ask, just humble yourself. Don't be so zealous. And ask who, what, when, where, why, and which, and you will get everything you need from the Lord, all right? So John 4, Jesus is talking to a woman at a well. And starting in verse 9, then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, let's start with 7. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give them shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, Sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Jesus saith unto her, Go call thy husband, and come hither. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, Thou hast said well, said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou hast is not thy husband, and that thou saidest thou truly. Whew. The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worship in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. Ye worship what we worship, that for the salvation of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that which worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. All right, so it's a lot, but look at the order in which Jesus prophesies, right? He has a word of knowledge. He says, like, hey, I know that you have had five husbands, and the guy that's with you now is not your husband. All spiritual gifts are supernatural in nature. All nine of them. They transform all our intellect, all our mental mentality, all right? And this is what we're relying on. But after that, and also, you have to be bold and have authority and dominion and walk in faith that the grace of God is carrying you and doing this prophetic work through you, because sometimes prophetic words are sharp. The word of God is a two-edged sword, able to cut asunder the thoughts of man from his heart, bone, and marrow. This is a spiritual sword, so it's going to cut deep. But it's just like a doctor's incision. It cleans up. So after you make an incision and you clean by a very piercing word, don't shy away from it, because a lot of people are doing zealous, charismatic, sensational words of knowledge and wisdom that are only encouraging. Everybody hated the prophets in the Bible. How are your prophetic words only fun and cupcakes and candy? They are very sharp. This is why they always killed the prophets all the time. So prophets are your doctors. They help by showing what's wrong. These are your consultants. They have to tell you what's wrong so your business runs better. These are your coaches. You have to have your form right, okay? But after he gives a sharp word or whatever, that's the edification. Sometimes to actually build up, you have to break down things that are impure, sin, transgression, and iniquity. He begins to teach. Usually, I'm not saying this is hand in hand, because the office of a teacher is different than the office of a prophet, but prophets are pretty good teachers. They're the mouthpiece of God. What is God saying? Okay? So he begins to teach her about the worshippers of God. He begins to give her the gospel. Somewhere in your prophecy, you need to give people the gospel of Jesus Christ, of repentance. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the gospel of repentance. It says, like, those who will worship God will worship him in spirit and truth. And he begins to prophesy and teaches her, like, hey, you can't even worship in the mountains. There's a time to come. He begins to prophesy about the last days, all things that are in the Bible. So again, prophecy does not contradict the Bible. But then you see that revelation comes. It says, in all you're getting, get understanding. You need to be able to properly distinguish and distribute the word of God, and also properly distribute the word of God being prophecy. And it said that study to show yourself approved, a good workman that need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So you can have the word of truth being the Bible, but you also have the word of truth being whatever prophecy you have. So that's why you need these follow-up questions: who, what, when, where, why, how, and which, so that you can properly teach people, right? And also, lastly, you should see instruction and comfort in these things. You can't just leave people hanging with a really harsh rebuke and not comfort them in repentance, in grace, in mercy. Even if they're going around the wrong path, it's like, hey, if you do not do this, you will die. But if you do